أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا ما يهدي الله فلا مضل له وما يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تسألون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم وما يطع الله رسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما وأما بعد Praise be to Allah, we seek His help and His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil of our own souls and our bad deeds. Whomsoever Allah guides will never be led astray, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can guide. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah. He is one. He has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ibn Abdullah is his servant and messenger. O ye who believe, fear Allah as he should be feared and die not except in the state of Islam. O mankind, be dutiful to your Lord who created you from a single person, and from him he created his wife, and from them both created many men and women. And fear Allah through whom you demand your mutual rights, and do not cut off the relations of the wombs that bore you. Surely Allah is ever and all watcher over you. O you believe, keep your duty to Allah and fear Him, and speak always the truth. He, Allah, will direct your righteous deeds and will forgive you your sins. And whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed achieved a great achievement. Verily, the best speech is the Book of Allah, the best guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the evil of all religious matters is their own innovation. Every innovation is a bid'ah, every bid'ah is a misguidance, and every misguidance is in the hellfire. Wa amma ba'd. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, in Surah Ali Imran, which is the third chapter, in verse 103, A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Wa tasimu bihablillah jami'an. Wa la tafarraqu wa adhkuru ni'matillah alaykum. إذ كنتم عداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمتي إخوانا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and hold fast altogether unto the bond with Allah. Hold fast to the bond or to the rope. Sometimes it's translated, hold fast to the rope of Allah. And do not draw away or do not separate yourselves from one another. And remember the blessings which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon you. How you were enemies and then he brought your hearts together. So how you were enemies and he brought your hearts together. So what? So that you may become brethren. So that you may become brothers. And this is a verse, when you look at the tafsir on this verse, you see that it was speaking about the tribes in Medina, when the Prophet went to Medina, and how these tribes were enemies of one another. And after the advent of the Prophet ﷺ, after he went to Medina, how they became brothers in Islam. And we're speaking about years, thousands of years, hundreds of years of fighting between these tribes. And then after the advent of Islam, what happened? Allah brought their hearts together as brothers in Islam. So this is what some of the Mufassir, this is what they say that this verse refers to. This idea that after the advent of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, these warring tribes, Allah brought their hearts together in Islam. Today's khutbah will focus on this idea of brotherhood. And how specifically brotherhood, how when we enact it correctly or when we do it the right way, the impact it can have on the relationships we have with each other. So I'm looking specifically at brotherhood and the impact it will have on our relationships. But before I get into that, on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, the Prophet said, all of a Muslim is prohibited. All of a Muslim is prohibited to another Muslim. In other narrations you hear, all of a Muslim is sacred to another Muslim. And what does this entail? So all of a Muslim is prohibited to another Muslim. What are those things? His blood, his honor, and his property. His blood, his honor, and his property. All of these things are sacred between Muslims. Each one of these things. And those things, although they sound very simple, his honor, his blood, and his property, they encompass a lot of things. They encompass so many things, and before the end of the khutbah today, inshallah, we'll touch on a number of them. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu also narrated that a messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the rights of a Muslim upon another Muslim are six. And many of us, we have heard this many times before. The rights of a Muslim upon another Muslim are six. And they said, and what are they, O Messenger of Allah? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, when you meet him, you greet him, you give him the greeting of peace. When he invites you, you respond to his invitation. When he seeks your advice, you advise him. When he sneezes and praises Allah, you supplicate for him. When he becomes ill, you visit him. And when he dies, you follow his janazah, or you follow him in his death. So we have the things that are sacred, three things, three broad categories of things that are sacred among Muslims. And then you have these rights that the Muslims speak about, these six rights that we all hear about so often. So inshallah, today I'm going to tie these rights to these broad categories of what is sacred and show how when we really hold these things up as it should be held up, what it does to our relationships and how it strengthens our relationships. So brothers and sisters, this is the gist of my khutbah today about brotherhood. So normally, up until this week, I was going to focus on speaking specifically about us in the community and how we can do things to bring us together. And that would be logical. I'm in Philadelphia, we speak about these things. I am still going to focus on that. But I think it would be insensitive to not touch on what happened in Boston this past week. I think it is mandatory and essential that as leaders in communities, we speak about tragedies when they happen, wherever they happen. So I want to focus on how the brotherhood helps develop these healthy relationships because it pushes us to focus on one another and not on ourselves. Lastly, brotherhood helps us develop better relationships by instilling in us a sense of sincerity and loyalty to each other and to the idea of goodness and justice in general. Essentially, brotherhood helps us develop healthy relationships by increasing us in compassion and gratitude, patience and forgiveness, and the love of justice, which brings trust. Each relationship needs compassion, forgiveness, and trust. These are staples for solid, strong relationships. These are duties that we have to one another as enshrined in our faith. And our faith itself speaks to this. As responsible Muslims, we need to be conscious of what we say and what we do. As responsible Muslims who are part of this humanity, we need to be conscious of what we say and what we do. So this week, after the bombings in Boston took place, Muslims did two main things. Two main things in general. We either apologized or we compared. We either apologized or we compared. When you look, these are the broad categories of the responses. What does the apology look like? In so-and-so terms, we strongly condemn so-and-so, yada, 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 yada. So we jump to the apology. I don't apologize every time a black man shoots another black man. I'm not going to apologize every time a Muslim does something wrong. But I'm not going to be insensitive about it. That brings me to my second group. The ones who say, 3 dead in Boston, 10,000 dead in Palestine. And they plaster that across their computer screens. As though it is a justification or validation that one is okay and the other one isn't okay. Insensitive at best. Insensitive at best. As Muslims, we condemn all crimes wherever they occur, whoever does them. But we cannot be insensitive to the hurt that is visited upon people when a tragedy happens. By trying to compare it to something else right after it happens. Yes, our minds will tell us that, hey, you know what? There might be more to this. Our rational reasoning will say, well, certain things aren't equal. But our heart is the thing that tells us there is a time and a place for everything. It is our heart that tells us when we need to be compassionate, not our minds. As Muslims, we function a lot with our minds and not with our hearts. And this is part of the problem with our brotherhood. We can rationalize why we don't have to treat a brother correctly. We can rationalize why we can speak ill about another brother or sister. We can rationalize all of these things, but put these things in your heart and see what your heart has to say about them. We think, but we don't feel enough. And this is a challenge of us in contemporary society today. This is one of our biggest challenges. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, his compassion overcomes his anger. What does Allah say? His compassion overcomes his anger. We are not Allah, and I'm not even going to make that comparison. So this is not the point I'm about to make. So there's no comparison between us and Allah. The question we then have to ask ourselves is, should we rest upon our anger or should we push forward more for our compassion? Which one should we really hold on to? Our anger or our compassion? Which one brings us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is not a black and white answer. But it has clear indication that anger doesn't always, in most cases, doesn't bring us closer to Allah unless we are angry for the right things in the right way. And many times, we are angry but not in the right way. Or we don't respond to it correctly. So the question then is, should our anger overcome our compassion? Let's look at the Prophet to get some clarity on this. And I'm not going to go into these stories. I have more stories based on this topic of brotherhood today, but just some very quick examples. We have the Bedouin who urinated in the masjid. What did the Prophet do? When other companions were angry, what did he do? Did he go and grab him by his collar and throw him out the masjid? No, he didn't do that. That is not what he did. We have the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. When the Prophet was, when Umar was narrating, yes, this is the Messenger of Allah, and when the Prophet was saying, Messenger of Allah, write down Messenger of Allah, and what did the Meccan say? Messenger of Allah, we don't know he's the Messenger of Allah, we know he's Muhammad. What did the companion say? You can't be so disrespectful. They wanted to cut their throats. What did the Prophet say? No, Muhammad, Ibn Abdullah. And lastly, there's a narration that speaks about how the Prophet he waited for a significant period of time for somebody to come meet him. He was supposed to meet someone, and he waited a number of days for the person to come meet him. And after a few days, then the person showed up. And when the person showed up, what did the Prophet do? He wasn't angry. He asked them, is everything okay with you? Compassion overcomes anger. This is the example of the Messenger of Allah. Is this our example? So going back to this idea of brotherhood and how it helps strengthen our relationships. Human relationships can only thrive if we are grateful and compassionate and look out for each other. So these are back to the 3 points I'm making. The 3 ways that brotherhood benefits our relationships is that if we are grateful and compassionate, it will strengthen the relationship. If we are forgiving, it will strengthen the relationship. And if we actually honor and protect our brothers and have a certain amount of loyalty, it will strengthen the relationship. So these are the 3 things I'll focus on. So human relationships can only be strong if we are grateful and compassionate and look out for each other. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the example of the believers, love, affection, and mercy for one another is like that of a body. When one of its organs ails, the rest of the body responds and watches over it by contracting fever. Meaning what? In our community, if one person ails or one part of the body ails, do we feel it? Are we even sympathetic towards it? More so empathetic. Do we just look at it and move on, like just a fact of life? Or do we actually stop and make a dua for the person who is experiencing what they're experiencing? Look at it like this. We know that the Prophet ﷺ said what? Somebody who is not thankful to mankind is not thankful to Allah. You see someone in difficulty. You know that you have the means to assist. Part of your gratitude or part of you showing gratitude is by assisting them. Or even when they do something for you or they give something to you and you do not show gratitude towards them, how are you saying that you're showing gratitude towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So someone comes in, they give you something and you just act as though they had a right to give it to you. You act as though this was your right and you're entitled to it and you don't show any gratitude towards it. Even if someone owed you money and you're entitled to that money, when you get that money, do you even say thank you? This is gratitude because that money didn't have to come to you. Why? Allah can withhold or grant what He wants. He who is not grateful to mankind is not grateful to Allah. This is clear. Gratitude should be one of the things that we are foremost in showing to each other. One of the rights of our brothers and sisters is what? That when they greet us with peace, we return the greeting with peace. And many of us, we walk down the street and we say, Assalamu alaikum, and it just rolls off our tongues. It's a very nice thing. It's easy to say, Assalamu alaikum. Some of us chop it up, Assalamu alaikum. Whatever we do, MashaAllah. But what does this greeting mean? When I look at you and I say Assalamu alaikum, this is what I am telling you. Your blood, your honor, and your property are safe with me. When I greet you with peace, this is what I'm telling you. That your honor, your blood, and your property are safe with me. That if you turn your back, I won't say anything harmful against you. And many of us, we give salams, and then we turn around and we say something bad against the other person right after that. That is not our greeting. When we give the greeting of peace, all of the things that come along with it get enforced. Not only does it say that your property, your blood, and your honor are safe with me, it also says what when I tell you Assalamu alaikum? That if I see someone violating your property, your blood, and your honor, I am going to stand with you in defense of it. This is what that brotherhood means. So if I'm sitting in the masjid and someone walks in and says, hey, you know what, Abdullah, he's a lying, cheating, whatever. What do I do? Yeah, you're right, he is. And you and Abdullah were just sitting eating a hoagie. You and Abdullah were just sitting and eating, and now you come to the masjid and you're encouraging someone to speak bad about him. This is not what Assalamu alaikum means when you give him that right. Our brotherhood should strengthen our relationships. Imam Al-Ghazali, I'll touch on three of the duties that he mentioned when he speaks of the duties of brotherhood: material assistance, personal aid, and managing of the tongue. All of these are still part of this first point. That our brotherhood is strengthened, our relationships are strengthened, when we are compassionate towards each other. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, under this point of material assistance, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, two brothers are like a pair of hands. One washes the other. Two brothers are like a pair of hands. One washes the other. So when we think of this idea of material assistance, Imam Al-Ghazali, he speaks of it, he said there are three degrees of it. The first basic level, which inshallah all of us are at least, is that if you have excess, you give. So meaning, to put it in very simplified terms, let's say you need $100 to live, you have $105, the $5 is excess, you give that away in charity. Basic. You know somebody needs a five, you give it to them. So that's one level, where you give only the excess that you have. The other level is where you want them to be equal to you. So if you have it, you give it to them so that you guys are on par with each other. So the first level is more like how you would treat somebody who is below you. And Imam Al-Ghazali in his Ihya, he speaks of it as how you would treat a slave or a servant. Like you make sure your slave or servant, they're comfortable. They're not on your same level, but you make sure that they have at least what they need to survive. So that's one level. The second level is when you treat them as though they're equal to you. You have it, you give it to them. You make sure that they have the same things that you have. The third level, which is the ideal of Islam, is what? That you prefer them to yourself. The quality of Siddiq. And we always hear of Abu Bakr Siddiq. We hear of that companion. And when we hear of him, we know his generosity. You prefer others over yourself. This is the third level of material assistance to your brother. How many of us actually live that in a real way? That we prefer others over ourselves. It is not an easy thing. And you don't get that just by doing it once. You have to continue doing this for this thing to become a quality of you. That is the ideal. That is what we strive for. But at least, don't fall past the point where if you have excess, that you give it in charity. How many of us, we are walking the street, and someone who is impoverished asks us for something, we have it in our pockets and we say, I don't have it. They ask, they look tattered and torn, they're smelly. And they say, can you give me something to eat? And because we're in such a hurry, I don't have it. How do we then validate that to ourselves? And then we turn around and we go to nice banquets, dress up in our suits and our ties, and we write checks for $100 and give it to the man in the suit. You write checks for $5,000 and give it to the man in the suit. But the one who looks like they're most in need of it, we turn our backs towards them. This cannot be our brotherhood. And worse yet, before they ask you, they give you salam. Salam alaikum, Afi. Can you give me a dollar? But because he's at 15th Street Station and he looks raggedy, you don't give him anything. This cannot be our brotherhood. This cannot be our condition. Personal aid. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the believer is one who does not go to bed with a filled stomach while his neighbor is hungry. This does not distinguish Muslim from non-Muslim. Neighbor. So if you know you're satisfied and you know that your neighbor is hungry and you go to bed, there's something wrong. You can't stand on that. So the believer is one who renders aid to the person when he asks, and the one who renders aid when the person is prevented from asking for whatever reason. You know the person needs aid, you offer them the aid. You know they need help, you offer it to them. But for this to happen, we have to want to see that our brothers and sisters are in need, and more importantly, we have to want to lift their burden. Or we have to want to be the instrument that Allah uses to ease that person's burden. Many of us don't want that enough. We don't want that enough. So how do we look out for our brothers and sisters in Philadelphia right now? You know that the husband and wife are going through it. You know that it's rough for them. The husband or the wife, they come and they speak to you and they say, so and so, you know what? This is a difficulty that I'm having right now. Remember, one of the things is when your brother or sister asks you for advice, you give them sincere advice. I gave a khutbah some time ago about what nasiha is and what sincere advice really looks like. So they're coming to you and they're telling you that they have a problem. And the help you offer to them is this. Don't give her any money. If she wants to be rude to you, don't give her any money. Let her stay in the house. Let her figure it out. Don't give any more maintenance, let her figure it out. Or to the wife, what, every night he comes home, you give him his food? Leave his food in the fridge, let him warm it up himself. This is how we help each other when we know that a husband and a wife are going through difficulties. We encourage them to keep that bond separated. We encourage them to escalate the conflict that they're experiencing. And we don't say something that helps them reduce the conflict or bring them back together. If this is how we treat each other, then we don't understand what this bond of brotherhood should represent. We have to want them to be in a better place. And you cannot do that if you're not giving them things that will better their soul. And I've heard it way too many times. Advice that people are giving, terrible advice. Terrible advice that they wouldn't want anyone else to give them. But yet still, we say that we are looking out for our brothers and sisters. Yet say we say that, well, you know what, you need to tie your camel, whatever that means now. I don't even know what that means anymore. It's like a catch-all for everything you want to do. Well, you know what? The prophet said you need to tie your camel. Like, that is our excuse to do everything else except what we should do. And brothers and sisters, you know what I'm speaking about. In Surah Al-Hujurat, it is mentioned, all the believers are brethren, so therefore make peace with your two brothers and remain conscious of Allah so that you may be graced with His mercy. Clear. If two people are at odds, what are you supposed to do? Make peace between them. Make peace. Strive your hardest to make peace between them. Teenagers, if your friends come to you and they say, hey, you know what? Abby, Umi, they're really getting on my nerves. And your advice to your friend is, well, just ignore them, don't pay any attention to them. That is bad advice. That is bad advice. So this is to my young brothers and sisters. Yes, we all have a time we want to be rebellious, but not against your parents. This is bad for you and bad for them. We have to want more than this. The Prophet ﷺ said, seek refuge from Allah, from the neighbor who conceals good when he sees it, but reveals the bad when he sees it. This is tied directly to Imam Al-Ghazali's, the third thing that I want to say in terms of strengthening relationships when we look out for each other, managing the tongue. There's this old maxim that there's this old tradition in Islam that, based on a hadith of the Prophet, that if you have nothing good to say, what do? Keep quiet. One of the things that we need to strive to do is, if we have nothing good to say, just bite down on the tongue a bit. That will save us so much trouble and so much agony. What do I mean by that? Imam Al-Ghazali suggested that if something bad is being stated about someone and you know it's the truth, one of the things that you should do is act like you don't even know. So if something bad is being said about someone, and what is being said, and I'm going to qualify this in a second, and what is being said is just bad and it's just for the sake of gossip, then you act and act as though you don't even know about it. Better yet, stop it, but act as though you don't even know about it. So they may say, Abdul, isn't that correct? I don't know. Even if I don't know, why are you asking me to confirm that that brother is a liar? I don't know. This is holding our tongues. This is what our brotherhood should look like. Think of how you and the relationship between you and another brother would look if this brother or sister knew that you are someone who, when someone comes to you with bad information, you stop it and you remove yourself from it. Think of the relationship that they would have with you if they know that you hold their honor as best as you can. And then think of what happens when someone finds out that you betrayed their trust. Think of how that relationship looks. And now compare the two and see which side you want to be on. When we enact our brotherhood, the rights and the responsibilities and the duties, our relationships become better. Without question. We talk about the Prophet ﷺ and the city of Medina with such reverence because it was a very special time. And we always want to go back to this time and we always romanticize about this idea of how this city was. And then, the best thing we can think of getting to that point is enacting a lot of laws to get us there. Rationalizing how we should get there. Not realizing that they had a strong city because it came from the heart. The hearts were the things that were united. Brothers and sisters, we cannot have a strong community and we cannot have strong relationships if we don't focus on uniting our hearts. The last thing I'll say before I break for the first half. Human relationships can only thrive if we are forgiving and patient with one another. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as reported by Abu Huraira, "O Abu Huraira, maintain good character." Abu Huraira then asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "And what is good character, O Messenger of Allah?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Connect with the people who shun you," meaning the people who move away from you, who cast you aside. Connect with them, try to reestablish some level of connection with them. Forgive those who wrong you, and give to those that deprive you. So if they held it from you, you give to them. If they wronged you, you forgive them. And if they shun you, you try to connect with them. This is good character. This is brotherhood. This is brotherhood. We have to find ways to be patient with one another and forgiveness and forgiven to one another. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said, "Indeed, truthfulness leads to righteousness and righteousness leads to heaven. And a man continues to tell the truth until he is recorded as before Allah as being somebody who is truthful. And indeed, lying leads to evil and evil leads to hell. And a man continues to lie until he is recorded as a liar before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Insulting a Muslim is impiety and killing him is a form of kufr or disbelief." I mention that here because yes, sometimes someone wrongs you and sometimes you want to just say the first thing that comes to your mind to let them know that you ain't no punk. But that isn't us. That is not us. That is not the brotherhood we strive for. The brotherhood we strive for says that you push yourself to try to be forgiving as best as you possibly can. You try to be forgiving as best as you possibly can. So I'm going to end this part with this. In chapter 41, which is Surah Fusilat, verse 34, it is said, "Good and evil cannot be equal. Repel then evil with what? With good. Repel evil with good or with something that is better. And between whom and yourself is anger or separation or enmity. It will happen as though you then become close after that." So this is the paraphrasing of what that verse said. So the best way to repay something evil that was done to you is with what? Something better. So Allah tells us what to do. Something bad is done to you, repay it with something better. We have this idea of like for like, and I always, you know, this in our community we continue to translate and miss juxtapose things that don't even make sense anymore. Eye for eye, like for like, and all of these things that we keep invoking as validation for not striving for something better. We could continue to lean on these crutches, or we could remove those crutches and strive for a better type of brotherhood. That really is the gist of it. We can continue to lean on these things that we've grown up with and we've heard all of our lives to validate and justify why we cannot do things better than we do them now, or we can really strive to do things better. Brothers and sisters, this is what we have to strive towards. These things are enshrined in the rights that we owe to each other. These things are enshrined in the duties that we have for each other. Honor is something that is sacred. When we are angry, we often violate each other's rights. So we get angry and we say things against each other, and that is not something that we should be doing. In all of the examples I've shown, this is not what we should be striving for. The believer is the one who, when somebody angers him, he tries his best not to to do something better than that. So I'm saying this especially to brothers and sisters, husbands and wives, imams and the ones who report to imams. I'm saying this to all of us, that we have to find ways to reach each other on a different level. Because if we continue like this, our brotherhood will continue to suffer and our relationships will continue to weaken. And we cannot build a strong community on weak relationships. We'll continue to see our youth leave our community en masse. We'll continue to see divorces rampant in our community en masse. And we'll continue to see new shahadas or new converts to Islam return to the ways of jahiliyyah en masse. And we'll continue to see zina en masse. With all of the ills that we see, we'll continue to see them until we take our brotherhood seriously. Brothers and sisters, I have a lot more that I can say about this, but I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives us our sins and grants us jannah. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us the straight path and gives us the good of this life and the good of the hereafter. The sad reality, brothers and sisters, is that most of us are ungrateful. We get more than we deserve, and we do not get punished as much as we should be get as much as we should get punished. Let us pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives us our sins and increases us in gratitude. Akulu qawli hadha wa astaghfiru li wa lakum. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Brothers and sisters, our brotherhood and sisterhood is what we have. It is the things that is the thing that defines our relationship to each other. And in fact, it symbolizes our connection with our Creator. Our brotherhood symbolizes that. We love our brothers and sisters for the sake of Allah. We do things for them as a form of service to them because we worship the Creator. Because we know that this is what brings us closer to them. This is what connects our hearts to them. When we do things in goodness towards them, this is our religion. Our brotherhood rests on this. We cannot say that we love Allah and we not be in service to mankind. We cannot say that we hate men or hate women and do things to harm them and think that this will not impact our relationship with the Creator. We turn into this Boston thing. And I said already, when a Muslim hurts another Muslim, that's kufr. That's a form of kufr. It's a form of disbelief. News is still coming out as to who the perpetrators are. Right now the news sources say it is two biological brothers from Chechnya. One got killed last night, and they're still on the search for the other one in the Boston area. So this is what the news reports say right now. We can no longer continue, even in our minds, to validate and justify Muslims killing indiscriminately. We can't do it. We can't say publicly one thing, and then when something bad happens to somebody, we're like, yeah, they deserve that. Yeah, you know, that's what a white man gets. Yeah. We need to stop that. That's psychosis. That's crazy stuff. We can't continue to do things the same way we've been doing them for a long time. We need to strive for a better ideal. So in closing, we need to find ways to be loyal to each other because this is one of the things that will strengthen our relationships. We need to find real and concrete ways to be loyal to each other. And how can we build this trust among one another? What does it mean to be loyal in the good and the bad? Think of that hadith, and I'll paraphrase it now, when the Prophet ﷺ said, when he said, help your brother whether he's doing good, whether he's the oppressed or the oppressor. And then they say, how? We know how we can help him if he's the oppressed, but how can we help him if he's the oppressor? Or if he's the one who is doing wrong? And what did the Prophet ﷺ say to do? Advise him to change. This is what we owe each other. To consistently help each other regardless of what side that person is on. This is what it means by ride or die. This is what it means by going down tight. That if your brother is doing something good, you encourage him. If he's doing something wrong, you help him move away from that in a good way. This is our brotherhood. This is what we have to strive for. So what is our action plan? This is what I suggest we do. First thing, let's start making more dua. The last time I was here, I said many times in which we can make dua. I said that there's a point in time between the adhan and the iqamah where there's a hadith that says between the adhan and the iqamah, guaranteed point in which dua is answered. I also said that there's a hadith that says when the rain falls, Allah accepts the dua. I also said that there's a hadith that says that in the last third of the night, Allah descends to the lowest heaven, and whatever we are praying for, He says, who is praying to me so that I can grant it to them. Many, many things or many opportunities we have to turn to Allah and ask Him for what we want. Let us increase let us take advantage of those opportunities. The iqamah hasn't been called as yet. Let us make dua for today. Tonight, it said it's supposed to rain. Another opportunity. It's Friday night. Many of us go out late and we come home late. Sometimes in the last third of the night. Make dua then. Easy stuff. It helps us. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring the evil criminals who perpetrate injustice anywhere they are to justice. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restore the health of those impacted by the bombings that took place in Boston earlier on this week. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restore the lives of those who are impacted by harm wherever they are, anywhere in the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the Muslims all around the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our Muslim brothers and sisters in Syria, Myanmar, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Palestine, you name it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect them wherever they are. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restore our dear sister Nyla Robinson to full health. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow her to recover from the trauma that she experienced. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow her and her family to be engulfed and encompassed by His mercy and His compassion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the grave of our beloved Imam Rashid spacious and full of light. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow him to pass over, to enter into Jannah with speed and with haste. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect his family who he has left behind. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us as a community to remember that although the Imam has died, that his family is still there and it is still on us to protect them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to not give up on the things that we should not give up on. I pray for Sister Roshana Williams, who is undergoing surgery today, and part of her body may be amputated. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows her to restore her to full health and allows her to come out of this safely. Amen. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants us forgiveness. Amen. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us the straight path. Amen. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us how to do things so that we can become better brothers and sisters. Amen. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives us our sins and grants us Jannah. اللهم اجنا من النار اللهم اجنا من النار اللهم اجنا من النار اللهم تقبل صلاتنا اللهم تقبل صلاتنا اللهم تقبل صلاتنا ان الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا ايها الذين امنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى ال محمد كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى ال محمد كما باركت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد او الله forgive us for our sins. O Allah, forgive us our sins. O Allah, forgive us our sins. O Allah, save us from hypocrisy, Ya Allah. Save us from hypocrisy, Ya Allah. Save us from hypocrisy, Ya Allah. O Allah, protect us from incompetence. O Allah, protect us from incompetence. O Allah, protect us from incompetence. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar. Allahumma inni as'aluka qalban shakiran. Allahumma inni as'aluka qalban shakiran. Allahumma inni as'aluka qalban shakiran. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa aqimus salat. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah. So Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in, Ihdina al-Sirat al-Mustaqim, Sirat al-Ladhina an'amta alayhim, Ghayr al-Maqdubi alayhim wa al-Dallin. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا قد أفلح من تزكى قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى إن هذا لفي صحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده ربنا الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم